Hello everyone, the name of the subject is Repair and Rehabilitation of Structure and today's topic is Portland Cement, which is a part of Unit 1 and 3rd lecture. These are some of the reference books. So let us start with the objective. To understand the properties of Portland Cement, to study the process of production of Portland Cement, to understand the components of Portland Cement, to derive the chemical reactions during its application. This is the picture of Portland cement that we use for construction of our buildings. Portland cement is a combination of gypsum plus Portland cement into a clinker. So the Portland cement clinker consists of calcareous and clay material while burning. And the paste is generated by Portland cement plus water. And the mortar is created by Portland cement plus water plus sand. And concrete is created by Portland cement plus water plus sand and coarse aggregate, which is gravel. So usually Portland cement, with cement we understand it is a bonding agent. Bonding agent is responsible for adhering all the materials all together and giving that compressive strength. So it is quite important, as this is the main crucial element which keeps all the other elements into a solid form. And this is a combination of chemicals which produce strength during hardening. And the chemical process takes place only in the presence of water. There is a condition where if the water is less, complete chemical reaction does not take place. So we have some areas of weakness or low strength. And if the water is high, the cement washes away with the water, so which again is a problem. So an optimum water level has to be maintained. So let us study about the raw materials for PC. PC is nothing but Portland cement. So first is calcareous rock, which is CaCO3, which is around 75%, which is used in Portland cement. So it is like limestones, chalk, and marine shell deposits. These are the main sources of calcareous rocks. Then the second type is argillocalcareous rocks, which is around 40% to which is around between 40% to 75%. And sources are cement rock, clay limestone, and clay chalk. Then argillaceous rocks, which are around less than 40%, which includes clay, shell, slate. And the Portland cement is made by mixing substances containing CaCO3 with substance containing SiO, Al2O3, Fe2O3, and heating them in a clinker, which is subsequently ground to powder. And then after that, subsequently it is ground to powder and mixed with 2 to 6% of gypsum. So as we know that these materials are the main constituents of Portland cement, but wherever the all these elements are again combined together, they are burnt into a clinker, where the clinker, the rock materials are properly burnt and ground to fine powder, and then the fine powder is again mixed with gypsum, which is in a percentage of 2 to 6%. So clinker, you can see the picture, and you can see the picture of gypsum. So this is what the clinker comes out. So all the raw materials which were burnt in clinker are small rock materials and gypsum. In this process, the gypsum and clinker are added to each other, ground to fine powder, and mixed very well. The production step. Raw materials are crushed, screened, and stockpiled. Rock materials are mixed with definite proportions to obtain mixed raw mix. They are mixed either dry, which is called dry mixing, or by water, which is called wet mixing. So the materials can be mixed with each other in two ways, which is one is dry form and in a wet form. where it is mixed directly without any addition of water is referred to as dry mixing, and whereas if the raw materials are mixed in the presence of water forming a slurry, then it is called wet mixing. Prepared raw mix is fed into the rotatory kiln, and as the material passes through the kiln, there temperature is raised above 1300 to 1600 degrees Celsius, and the process of burning is named as burning. The process, the output is known as clinker, which is 0.15 to 5 centimeter in diameter. So it's a small chunks of rocks, which is a combination of all the raw materials that has been added into it. Okay. Clinker is cooled and stored. Then the clinker is ground with gypsum. Gypsum is added in an average percentage of 3 to 6% to adjust the setting type. Gypsum is a very good adjusting, it adjusts setting time of the cement. So it gives you time for preparation, initial and final setting time. Then it is exported, then it is packaged and marketed out for different construction sites. So this is what a typical cement factory looks like. It has a lot of storing tanks, and there we can see a clinker. And the main packaging and marketing area where all the labeling and other stuff are done. There are other major units where the raw materials and the finished materials are stored. Okay, so this is a brief outlay of how everything is formed. So the boulders go into the quarry, which is primary crusher. The primary crusher crushes them to smaller pieces, and then a vibrating screen where all the crushed material is separated, sieved out, and the larger particles are again crushed. Then the sample is taken to the sample station, where the segregation of rock storage takes place. Okay, and then therefore it goes into all the raw materials are gone, is taken to another station where all the raw materials are stored together and mixed properly. Then there are some blending silos which blend the raw materials thoroughly, and after that it goes into raw grinding ball mill, where the raw material is further grinded into finer particles which are extremely homogeneous. Okay, and then it is taken to a homogeneous silos, homogenizing silos, and then the kiln is fed to the silos, and from the silos it is taken to kiln where the dust is collected and the hard rock raw materials are transported through the rotating kiln, where the raw materials are burned to a degree of 1300 to 1600 degrees Celsius, and the end result is in the form of clinkers, which are small rock-like particles, burnt rock-like particles. Then the clinkers and the gypsum is stored in a particular container where it is stored together to a percentage, to the desired percentage, and then it is transported to a finishing grinding mill where the thorough crushing of the powder takes place, and all the sieving, all the fine materials are sieved out. Only the finely sieved material is taken to a storage where bulk storage is done. After that, after bulk storage, the stored material is again packaged and transported for construction. So this is basically the whole picture of how Portland cement is constructed. We'll discuss everything in detail in the upcoming slides. So this is the most important part wherein you have to understand. The raw material is fed through this chamber. Then there are every zones where free water, free clay decomposes. With every raw material passing through each stage, a different process takes place. In the initial, the free water gets evaporated. Then the clay decomposes properly, and all the organic material is totally decompose. Then the limestone reaches almost a mid stage where the limestone starts to decompose. Then after that, the formation of initial compound takes place. Moving forward, the initial formation of dicalcium silicate takes place at an area and the formation of tricalcium silicate. Then the heat is produced from the lower version where the heat can travel all through the kiln. So the whole the kiln is divided into basically four parts, where first is a dehydration part where the water and the clay organic matter are decomposed. The second part where calcination takes place, which includes limestone decomposition, formation of initial compound and formation of dicalcium silicate. And the third part where the clinkering zone is called and where tricalcium silicate forms. And the last zone is cooling zone. And as an output, we receive clinkers. The reaction in kiln, so around 100 degrees Celsius, the free water which is present in the raw materials gets evaporated totally. And from 150 to 350 degrees Celsius, the loosely bound water is lost from the clay. And it properly cleans up all the organic matter which may be present in the clay. So it is totally destroyed and completely free from organic matter. Then about from 350 to 650 degrees Celsius, the decomposition of the clay takes place, which is SiO2 and Al2O3. Then above, then for 600 degrees Celsius, the decomposition of MgCO3 and MgO and CO2 evaporates. Like these gases are formed, this compound is formed, and the CO2 gets expelled out. By 900 degrees Celsius, the decomposition of CaCO3, which gives products which is CaO and CaO2, takes place, where CO2 is again released into the atmosphere. About in the temperature 1250 to 1280 degrees Celsius, liquid formation and start of compound formation. Here the compound formation refers to as Bogie's elements, Bogie's compounds. Those things start to form at this stage. And above and after this, after 1280 degrees Celsius, the clinkering begins. So after clinkering temperature of 1400 to 1500 degrees Celsius, the complete clinkering takes place. Then again, the temperature is reduced to 100 degrees Celsius, where the clinkers leave the kiln and falls out of the into a cooler. And a cooler is responsible for cooling all the clinkers and storing them. So sometimes the burning process of raw material is performed in two stages, that is preheating up to 900 degrees Celsius and rotating. The chemical composition of Portland cement. The Portland cement is composed of four major oxidized, which is CaO, SiO2, Al2O3, Fe2O3, which can be greater than or equal to 90%. And minor oxides refer to the quantity, not importance. So we have some oxides, CaO, which is commonly known as lime, abbreviation as C, and approximately quantity of lime is around 60 to 67%. SiO2, which is also known as silica, it is abbreviated as S, is present in the quantity of 17 to 25%. And Al2O3, which is also known as alumina, abbreviated as A, is present in a quantity of 3 to 8%. Fe2O3, which is iron oxide, F, which is present in the quantity of 0.5 to 6%. Na2O, which is soda, normally known as N. It is not definite. If there is a need for additional property in the Portland cement, only then this is added. Potassium, K2O, potassium. K is also, and again, admixture, like a chemical which is added to give additional characteristics to the potentiator. So Si2O3 sulfuric aldehyde, which is S, is around 1 to 3%. Okay. CaO is nothing but limestone, and Si2 minus Al2O3 is abbreviated as clay, which is chemical formula for clay. Then Fe2O3 is the purity in clay. SiO2 from gypsum, SiO3 from gypsum, not from the clinker. The amount of oxides in PC depends in the proportioning of the raw material and how well the burning is done in the kiln. The chemical composition is found by chemical analysis, a typical analysis of OPC. OPC is nothing but ordinary Portland cement. So this value has been given. Insoluble residue is around 0.2 and loss of ignition is around 1.4. Moving forward, CaC, which is calcium oxide, calcium, which is lime, and silica and alumina and iron oxide are major oxides that interact in the kiln and form the major components. So these are the major four components which give the maximum. They cover the maximum proportion of the concrete, like proportion of the cement, Portland cement. The proportion of these oxides determine the proportion of the compounds which affect the performance of the cement. SiO3 comes largely from gypsum. This is the reason why gypsum is added, just to obtain SO3. And as we know that SO3 or gypsum is known for giving the setting time, providing setting time for the concrete, and it can be adjusted with the amount of gypsum added in the cement. Portland cement alone sets quickly, so some gypsum is ground with clinker to retard its setting time. So it is gypsum is the most important ingredient which allows the manufacturing of concrete at a place, and transportation of that same concrete to a construction site takes can be successfully taken place because of addition of gypsum, where final setting time can be retarded, and gypsum is added to a quantity which many which helps in the transportation with which helps in transportation along with the retardation of setting time. If too much gypsum is included, it leads to disruptive explanations of the hardened paste of concrete. So if too much of gypsum is added, what happens? There will be some portions where disruptive expansions will take place, and the hardened concrete will have areas of problem and will have some expansions which are not uniform and disruptive. So around, like as per ASTM C 150, which is SO3, which is gypsum, is either less than, is maintained less than or equal to 3% in OPC, and MgO plus H2O, which is MH, C plus HCH, volume expansion and cost cracking. So this has to be kept in mind, because the volume expansion and cost cracking thing happens if excessive gypsum is added to the concrete structure. So as per ASTMC, if the M is less than 6%, then 3C equals to should also be kept with around 3%. So alkalis. So Na2O plus K2O may cause some difficulties if the cement is used with certain type of reactive aggregates in making concrete. The alkali in the form of alkaline hydroxide can react with the reactive silica of the aggregate, resulting in the volume expansion and after hardening. This process may take years, and Na2O and K2O is kept below or equal to 0.6%. So these are nothing but alkalis, which is in the form of Na2O O and K2O, which are the main reasons to some difficulties which can happen after hardening. There are regions, there are portions or regions where excessive expansion and aggressive reaction can take place, due to which there may be can react, and the reactive silica in the aggregates results in extreme high volume expansion after hardening. So after hardening, if there is a huge expansion, it results in cracks. So you should always keep in mind that the quantity of gypsum should be kept below or equal to 3 to 6%. Then there are insoluble residues, in that the fraction of cement which is insoluble in HCl, hydrochloric acid, it comes mainly from silica which has not reached to form compounds during the burning process in the kiln. All compounds of the Portland cement is soluble in HCl except the silica. So there is insoluble residue which is mainly silica, and most of the components in Portland cement get properly dissolved in hydrochloric acid, but silica is the only element which does not dissolve properly, and it is left out as a residue. So the amount of IR determined by the chemical analysis serves to indicate the completeness of the reactions in the kiln. So IR is nothing but insoluble residue. So with the amount of residue, we can determine the chemical analysis, which is responsible for it, indicates the completeness of the reaction in the kiln. That is the main process where we understand if the process of burning the raw material is totally completed. As per ASTM of 150, the IR is kept either less than or equal to 0.75%. Loss of ignition. Loss of ignition is the loss in the weight of cement after being heated to 100 degrees Celsius, 1000 degrees Celsius. It indicates the prehydration and carbonation due to prolonged or improper storage of cement and clinker. Okay, so loss of ignition is nothing but the loss of weight of cement, because after heating, a lot of chemicals and compounds get released in the form of gases and which are flushed out. So obviously, there is a decrease in the weight of the cement. So this process is called loss on ignition. If the cement is exposed to air, water, and carbon dioxide are absorbed, and by heating the cement up to 100 degrees loses their substances. So loss of ignition has to be kept as per ASTM. The loss of ignition has to be kept either less than or equal to 3% of OPC, ordinary Portland cement. So the compound composition of PC or clinker. So what is the main composition that we do in Portland cement? So oxides interact with each other in the kiln to form more complex product, which has good strength, which has proper bonding strength, and after hardening, it provides extremely high compressive strength. So basically, there are four major components which are produced in Portland cement. They are also known as bogies compound, and one is tricalcium silicate, which is C3S, calcium silicate, which is C2S, tricalcium aluminate, that is C3A, tricalcium aluminoferrite, which is C4AF. So these are the four major bogies compounds which are produced in Portland cement, which are responsible for hardening of concrete. Okay, so the degree to which the potential reaction can proceed to equilibrium depends on the fineness of raw material and their intermixing. So it is required that all the raw materials are thoroughly mixed, and next, the temperature and the time that mix is held is a critical zone in the kiln. So proper timing should be maintained, along with proper temperature has to be maintained during the burning process inside a kiln. The grade of cooling of clinker may also be effective to the internal structure of the major compound, because if there is improper cooling, the surface may undergo rapid cooling and the internal may remain hot, which can defect again the production of bogies compounds. There are also some minor compounds which contribute to few or almost negligible compounds. Moreover, Portland cement compounds are rarely pure. For example, C3S MgOn A2O3 replaces CaO randomly, which is C3S alites or C2S belites. Okay, so these compounds, they replace CaO to form alites and belite. The ferrite phase in which the C4AF is produced is not a true compound. The ferrite phase ranges from C2AF to C6AF, but C4AF is represented as an average, but there is also production of C6AF. So there are some influence of the compounds produced in the Portland cement. So the major characteristics of Portland cement is, when Portland cement with water, the compound of the cement undergoes chemical reaction with water independently, and different products result from these reactions. Like, for example, rate of reaction initially for C3S, tricalcium silicate is moderate, for dicalcium silicate it's low, and C3A, tricalcium aluminate is fast, and tetracalcium aluminoferrite is moderate. Similarly, for the liberation, the heat liberation is high for C3S, low for C2S, very high for C3A, and moderate for C4AF. Early cementitious value is good for C3S. C2S, it's very poor, but C3A is good, and again, C4AF is poor. And ultimate cementitious value is C3S gives the initial hardening, C2S gives the final hardening. C3A does not provide any hardening properties, so it is poor, and C4AF again is another component which does not provide any hardening cementitious property, so it is poor. As per ASTM type and name of the PCC, the type 1 OPC, which constitutes this proportion of C3S, C2S, C3A, and C4AF, is used for general purposes. Modified version is used for moderate high heat of hydration, which can be used for most of the high-rise buildings. Then high early strength, which is used for any structure which needs rapid hardening properties, like water structures require extreme high strengthening, early high strengthening. So in that proportion, the C3S, the value or the proportion of C3S, C2S, C3A, and C4AF is altered to get desired property. And then for a very low heat PC, we know that C3A is the major heat producing element component in Portland cement. So that value is kept very low, and C2S is drastically increased. Then for the type 5, where the sulfate resistant Portland cement, the value of C3A is kept low, and other values are kept the same. But the limit on C3A is only less than or equal to 5%, more than 5, not more than 5 can be used, because then it directly reacts with the aggregates. So hydration of PC refers to the chemical reaction with water. As water comes into contact with cement particles, hydration reaction immediately starts at the surface of the particles, although simple hydration such as CH bonds are formed. CH bonds are formed. Process of Hydration is a complex one and results in reorganization of the constituents of original components to form a new hydrated components compounds. So you can see the picturization of unhydrated cement particles, a cementitious gel, and a capillary pore and cavities. So after immediately after mixing, the cement particle is not properly hydrated, but after a while, after stiffening, during early stiffening, the part B, the picture B shows the structure of unhydrated cement where the cement particles is coated with water, and the formation of skeletal structure is the third C picture, which shows the initial signs of hardening. And lastly, then picture D refers to the gel infilling, which is a process where the later hardening takes place. At any stage of the hydration, the hardened cement paste consists of hydrates of various compounds referred to collectively as gel, and the crystals of calcium hydroxide, CH, which was formed, and some minor compounds of hydrates. Then unhydrated cement can be formed, and the residue water fills spaces pores. So the residual water gets filled up in all the voids or the pores in between the cement paste. As the hydration process of the deposit of hydrated products on the original cement grains makes the diffusion of the water to unhydrated nucleus or nucleus more and more difficult. Thus, the rate of hydration decreases with the time, and as a result, hydration may also take several years. So, cement takes a lot of time for hydration, and some products they are hydrated. Initially they are well hydrated, but then as the nucleus becomes, the fusion of water takes place, and the unhydrated nucleus becomes more and more difficult to be properly saturated. So the rate of hydration eventually decreases with the increase of hardening. The major compounds start to produce, which is calcium silicate hydrate gels and calcium hydroxides and calcium alumino sulfuride. Upon hydration, C3S and C2S also and CH are formed, which becomes an integral part because these are the elements which provide the initial strength, the major strength to the portlandzimen. So CH does not contribute much in the strength, but C3S and C2S are the major components which provide strength to the portlandzimen. C3S, having a faster rate of reaction accompanied by greater heat generation, is the first compound which starts the hardening process and the initial setting time. So C3S, having a faster rate of reaction accompanied by a greater heat generation, develops early strength to the paste. On the other hand, C2S hydrates and hardens slowly. So C2S is responsible for the final setting time, final hardening, final strength gaining of the concrete. C2S, the results in less heat as compared to C3S, but it gives the ultimate strength. It provides the ultimate strength to the Portland cement. The higher the C3S, the higher will be the strength in the earlier stage. And whereas higher the C2S will give you strength on the later part. C3A is characterized as, so the C3A is characteristically fast reacting with water and will lead to rapid stiffening of the paste. So with a large amount of heat generation, in order to prevent this rapid reaction, gypsum is added. So here the function of gypsum comes in, where the gypsum is used to adjust the setting time of the concrete, because if the concrete is prepared in a ready mix plant, the concrete needs to be transported to the construction site. So the duration between that is altered using a gypsum. So gypsum, if the distance is large, the gypsum in higher quantity is added to the concrete. If distance of the ready mix concrete plant to the construction site is less, then the comparatively less amount of gypsum is added to the mixture. Gypsum and C3A and water reacts to form relatively insoluble calcium sulfoaluminates. Also, calcium sulfoaluminates are prone to less resistance to sulfate attack and does not contribute much for strength. So this these are usually prone to sulfate attacks extremely. So for this process, the aluminate has to be kept on the lower side. The calcium, the cement to be used in making concretes that are going to be exposed to soil or water that contains sulfate should not contain more than 5% of C3A, because C3A will be easily affected by sulfate attack, and due to sulfate attack, again the deterioration of the concrete can take place if it is exposed with soils containing minerals and water, which can hamper the ultimate strength of the concrete and cause deterioration. C4AF, the hydration of ferrite phase, is not well understood, but the ferrite phase has lesser role in the development of strength. The hydration product are similar to C3A, and the alumina and iron oxide can occur interchangeably in the hydration products. Heat of hydration is a major point, because heat of hydration is the major process which takes place during the chemical reaction between cement and water, and the heat generated to maintain the heat of hydration to cool the system and help the concrete to undergo a lot of chemical reaction. Regular curing is done, but as concrete is the fair insulator, the generated heat in the mass concrete may result in expansion and cracking. So this can be overcome by using a suitable type of cement. It could also be advantageous for cold weather concreting. For areas having very low temperatures, such concretes can be used where heat of hydration produced is in a large quantity. The heat of hydration of OPC is on the order of 85 to 100 calories per gram. So you can see that the heat of hydration for OPC is quite large, and about 50% of this heat is liberated within 1 to 3 days, and 75% within 7 days. By limiting C3S and C3A, the content of heat of hydration can be reduced. So, maintaining all the four components, bogies, compounds, we can alter and derive all the desirable properties for OPC. So, these are the the heat of hydration chart as per with respect to time. So, you can see the heat of hydration releasing as per the time of concrete hardening. The heat of hydration for pure compounds is mentioned below, and it is as per the IS code. The amount of heat liberated is affected by the fraction of compounds in the cement. So if you alter with the proportion of compounds, you can alter with the heat of hydration. The heat of hydration is given below, which is around 120 times of percent of C3S plus 62. This is a formula for altering, to derive the amount of heat of hydration which can be derived, and the percentage which can be used to get this proportion. So C3S, you have a heat of hydration of about 120, and C2S about 62, C3A 207, and around C4AF around 100. Fineness of cement, hydration takes place at the surface of the cement particles. It is the surface area of the cement particles which provide material available for hydration. So the finer material, there will be the more surface area for hydration. The rate of hydration is controlled by fineness of cement. For a rapid rate of hydration, a higher fineness is necessary. So the like the cement, the fineness of the cement is kept to the optimum level, where to increase the surface area for hydration so that the process can take place in a rapid rate. However, higher fineness requires higher grinding, which is cost. Cost in terms of cost, it becomes really expensive. And finer cement deteriorates faster upon exposure to atmosphere. So an optimum, like very fine, will require a lot of money. Plus, again, it will be highly corrosive, and it will deteriorate very fast. Finer cements are very sensitive to alkali aggregate reaction. Again, with the exposure of alkali in the environment, it is bound to deteriorate very fast. And finer cement requires more gypsum for proper hydration. Again, gypsum, the more quantity of gypsum, again, values to a more cost of production. Finer cements require more water, again, which can lead to bleeding and segregation. Fineness of cement is determined by air permeability test. This is a test which is used to determine the fineness of cement, and Blaine air permeability method is used, where the volume of air is passed through the cement and the time is recorded and specific surface is calculated by a formula. The fineness is expressed in terms of specific surface of the cement, which is centimeter square per gram. So for OPC, specific surface is around 2,600 to 3,000 centimeter square per gram. So this is Blaine apparatus, which is used to calculate the fineness of cement. And this is the sieving material through which the air is passed. So setting refers to the change from liquid state to solid state. Although during setting cement paste acquires more strength, setting is different from hardening. In this, setting means the initial chemical reaction starts to take place, but when during setting time, if the mold is removed, again the concrete will not be able to retain shape and it will collapse. The water content has a marked effect on the time of setting. In acceptance, test of cement and water content is regulated by bringing the paste to a standard condition of wetness. This is normally called as normal consistency. A normal consistency of OPC ranges from 20 to 30% by weight of cement. A Weikert apparatus is used for determining the normal consistency, and the normal consistency is that common condition, is that condition for which the penetration of a standard weight plunger into the paste of 10 mm in 30 seconds. By trial and error method, we determine the water cement ratio. And in practice, the term initial and final setting are used to describe the arbitrary chosen time of setting. The initial setting indicates the beginning of noticeable stiffening, and the final setting time may be regarded as the start of hardening or complete loss of plasticity. So if there is complete loss of plasticity, the cement paste will start to retain its shape even without the mold. So these are the two apparatus which can be used to measure the consistency of cement. One is Weikert needle and Gilmore needle. Setting can be obtained by using Weikert apparatus, and this is the reading that we get for ASTM C150. The initial time is around 45 minutes and the final setting time is around 375 minutes. For TS19, the initial setting time is 1 hour, which is 60 minutes, and final setting time is around 8 hours, which is 480 minutes. Factors affecting settling time: the temperature, humidity, amount of water, chemical composition of cement, fineness of cement. Finer the cement, faster will be the setting time. So all these factors affect the setting time, and these things have to be kept in mind. If the temperature of the construction site is extremely high, high rate of evaporation may take place, due to which excessive water can be evaporated and improper like chemical reaction in between the cement can take place. Chemical composition of the amount of water is also quite important, because less water will result in improper chemical reaction, but excessive water can result into bleeding. So optimum water level has to be maintained. Chemical composition of cement is again the altering of all the bogies compounds, which is C3S, C2S, C3A and C4AF. Fineness of cement, fineness of cement also is very important factor for the setting time, as the finer the cement, there will be faster will be the setting time. So the abnormal setting is set, flash set and false set. Flash set is the immediate stiffening of the cement in a few minutes after mixing of water. It is accompanied by large amount of heat generation upon reaction of C3A. Just to counter this part, we add gypsum. So just to counter C3A, we add gypsum so that the flash set can be minimized. And gypsum is placed in the cement to prevent flash set, and the rigidity cannot be overcome and plasticity may not be regained without addition of water. So amount of gypsum must be such that it will be used up to almost hardening, and it should be finished by then. And after that, the gypsum need not be present in the concrete mixture, because the expansion causes by entringite can be distributed to the paste before hardening. More gypsum will cause undesirable expansion, so it is added in a quantity wherein the just before the hardening phase, all the gypsum gets used up. False set is a rapid development of rigidity without generation of much heat. This rigidity can be overcome, and plasticity can be regained by further mixing without addition of water. In this way, the cement paste restores its plasticity and sets in a normal manner without any loss of strength. For this, there is very less generation of heat, which should be kept in mind. So the probable cause of false set is when gypsum is ground by too hot of a clinker. Gypsum may be dehydrated into hemihydrates, which is CaSO4.5H2O, and anhydrates, which is CaSO4. These materials, when react with water, gypsum is formed, which results in stiffening of the paste. Alkali oxides in cement may carbonate during storage. Upon mixing such a cement with water, these alkali carbonates will react with CaOH twice, CH calcium hydroxides liberated by hydroxyl of C3S, resulting in CaCO3. CaCO3 replicates, precipitates in the mix and results in false set. Soundness of cement is defined as the volume stability of cement paste. The cement paste should not undergo large changes in the volume after it has set. Free CaO and MgO may result in unsound cement. Upon hydration, C and M will form CHMH with volume increase, thus cracking. So it should be such that the large changes in volume should not take place, because of which the cracking can paste can result into forming cracks. Since unsoundness is not apparent until several months or years, it is necessary to provide an accelerated method for its determination. So there are some methods, like it is Lee-Chettiar method. Only free CaO can be determined, and autoclave method, by which both CaO and MgO can be determined. Strength of cement. The strength tests are not carried out on a neat cement paste, because it is very difficult to form these paste due to cohesive property of the cement. So it is mixed with sand to to find out the strength of cement. The strength tests are carried out on the cement mortar. Mortar means cement, sand, and water. Prepared by standard gradation of one part of cement, three parts of sand, and half part of water. So this is MTS instrument, which is used to calculate the strength of concrete. Okay. We have to understand that the cubic sample which we have, it undergoes a lot of compressive strength, tests, which is forces acting inward, and it is derived by a formula. And similarly, flexural sample is broken as it is pulled apart, and the flexural strength can be derived from this formula. So these are the two equipments, one for A, for compressive test, and the other for the tensile flexural test. Types of Portland cement. There are different cements of different chemical composition and physical characteristics, which may exhibit different properties when hydrated. It should be thus, it should thus be possible to select mixture of raw materials for the production of cement with various properties. So you can use different properties, different materials, and create a proportion to achieve a desirable property for the concrete. It can be altered as per the need of the construction. In fact, several cement types are available, and most of them have been developed to ensure durability and strength properties to concrete. So let's move forward to the multiple choice question. This set of concrete technology, this is a set of concrete technology multiple choice questions, and the answers are given for Portland cement. So dash is not used to make Portland cement. Calcareous rock, argillo calcareous rocks, argilla calcareous rock, and sand. So sand is mixed with cement to make concrete mortar instead of making cement. So material can which we get from these three rocks are useful to make healthy Portland cement. Which one does not come under calcareous rock? Limestone, cement rock, chalk, marine shell deposits. The answer is B, cement rock. Cement rocks come from the Algerio calcareous rock, and the calcareous rock have limestones, marl, chalk, marine shell deposits. Third, what is the percentage of clinkers in Portland cement? 2 to 3%, 4 to 6%, 2 to 6%, 3 to 5%. The answer is 2 to 6%. Explanation: Portland cement is made by mixing substances containing CaCO3 with substances containing SiO, Al2O3, F2O3, and heating them to a clinker, which is subsequently ground to a powder and mixed with 2 to 6 grams of gypsum. As the material passes through the kiln, their temperature is raised up to 1300 to 1600 degrees Celsius, 1100 degrees Celsius, 1500 degrees Celsius, 1300 degrees to 1500 degrees Celsius, 1100 to 1600 degrees Celsius. So the answer is 1300 to 1600 degrees Celsius. 1300 to 1600 degrees Celsius is the best range to melt the raw materials for a healthy Portland cement. Below 1300 degrees Celsius, the material which is added will be added to make the Portland cement won't melt perfectly, and the result will be an unhealthy Portland cement. What is the diameter and the length of the kiln respectively? So if it is diameter should be 6 and 200 meters, 200 meters and 6 meters, 6 meters and 6 meters, 200 meters and 200 meters. So the answer is 6 meters and 200 meters. They are produced in a range of sizes and units, with diameters up to 6 meters and length up to 200 meters have been made. What is the range of, this is sixth question, what is the range of CaCO3 in Argy calcareous rocks? So is it greater than 75%, between 40 to 75%, less than 75%, or equivalent to 75%? The answer is 40 to 75%. The explanation is that it is a standard value in RG calcareous rock. 40 to 75% CaCO3, such as clayey limestone and clayey marl, is used. Prepared raw mix is fed into the rotatory kiln, true or false? Cement kilns are used for the pyro processing stage of manufacturing of Portland cement and other types of hydraulic cement, in which the calcium carbonate reacts with silica bearing minerals to form mixture of calcium silicates. What is the diameter of clinker for making of Portland cement? 0.15 to 5 centimeters, 0.15 to 5 meters, 0.3 to 4 centimeters, 0.3 to 4 meters. The answer is A. As the material passes through the kiln, the temperature is raised up to 1300 to 1600 degrees Celsius. The process of heating is named as burning, and the output is known as clinker, which is 0.15 to 5 centimeter in diameter. What is the composition of making the mortar? Portland cement plus water, Portland cement plus water plus sand, Portland cement plus water, sand and gravel, water, sand and gravel. So the answer is B. Mortar is mixed with three material, that is cement, water, sand, and Portland cement plus water plus sand gives you mortar. Whereas adding coarse aggregate, Portland cement, sand, water and coarse aggregate will give you concrete. Is used for building, for holding bricks and stones together, or for plastering purposes. Cement is a material with adhesive and cohesive properties. Is it true or false? The answer is true. Cement is a material with adhesive and cohesive properties, which make it capable for bonding material fragments into compact whole. Thank you.